this powerful little book. It is amazing. It's not even 100 pages. And it is power-packed. I have been able to take each little tiny chapter and make a talk out of it. That's how powerful it is. If you don't own it, I highly suggest you purchase it. It's called The Game of Life and How to Play It. And it's by Florence Scovel Shinn. So she is an amazing woman. She lived at the time of Ernest Holmes. You know, you can Google her to look up everything about her. And I just think she is such a wealth of information on how to live our life. And so this week, we get to talk about love. I know, because we cast out our burdens last week, so what's left? Love is left. And Patty Berry had given a talk, or a class, to the Core Council on the Practitioners, and she talked about acronyms. And I love acronyms, and Reverend Susie adored acronyms. She was my mentor up in Seattle, the first place I ever went to a center, and she, almost all of her talks would be based out of acronyms. And so I thought of her this morning, or last night, as I was like, oh, love, what am I going to say about love? I could start with the Beatles song, you know, all you need is love, how true that is. So love, so if we look at the L, to be in relationship with ourselves, because I think we can't love anybody else, really, unless you love yourself. If you don't fully love yourself, then when you're in relationship with somebody, what you are looking for is somebody that's going to fill those holes where you don't like yourself. And that's kind of like a puzzle piece. And then what can happen to a puzzle piece, it can, whew, and then you're kind of looking at each other like, well, you know, why aren't you behaving the way I want you to behave? You know, and so it's that when you truly are in love with yourself, then you can truly love others. And I'm not saying, you know, fully in love with yourself, I still work on that every single day. I don't know if I do all, but there's that Dallas thing. Don't know. It's hanging on. But anyway, I was in Dallas last week for those of you who weren't here. And so y'all has become part of my vocabulary for some reason. However, so love, so the L, so it's listen. Listen. And so when you're in love with yourself, what do you listen to? You listen to that still, small voice within. That part of the divine that lives within you. You know, somebody asked me about my higher power, and if I believe God was in me, then how did I define my higher power? And I said, I'm just a minuscule part of that magnificent divine. And I always say, kind of like it is a thing, that in its sense of humor, when it said, oh, I'm going to birth humans, it said, and I'm going to give you free will. And so in me is all of it. Every single bit of it is my soul. And my soul is nothing but whole, complete, and perfect. That is my soul. And because humorous, or whatever, maybe it was like, oh, go out there and learn some more, that when we birth into this with our free will, we get to choose. We get to choose how we behave. Are we always going to be in joy? Are we always going to be happy? Are we always going to be loving? Are we always going to be compassionate? And, you know, always? Yeah. I would say for myself, not so much. I practice, and my intent is to always be that. And sometimes I fall flat on my face. And other times I practice, and it's not perceived that I practice. And that's okay, because everybody gets to receive my love exactly as they choose. However, loving myself first. And sometimes it takes somebody sitting down and saying, this is what I see. Even for a minister, even for a practitioner, even for your mother, your father, whoever that is, because we get caught up in daily life and our feelings get hurt or whatever happens. And having somebody that has the courage to sit across from you and say, this is who you are. This is who you are. And don't let anybody pull you off of that, because that's the gift you give. So that was loving that, you know, also loving that you get to receive. You get to listen to that when somebody tells you something loving. And I used to do something like that. La, 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 la. They can't hear you. so you listen to the divine, that still small voice within. You listen to those people who encourage you and lift you up and sometimes grab you by the shoulder and shake you and say, hey, this is the truth of who you are. Because we all forget. And sometimes our soul gets so tired, it just falls asleep. And it's good for somebody to kind of go, hey! You know, that's what I believe I do here every Sunday. It's that, hey! It's how we start our week. You know, if one of us just gets a little bit more light in our soul and then goes out into the world for a whole week, wow. Don't believe vibrationally you're not changing the world one way or the other. One way or the other. So it's listen. The L is listen. The O, it's not working. Just so you know, because I'm a UW fan, so this is what they do with their football games. But the O is observe, witness. Not only for yourself, not only of others, but witness yourself. Sometimes, almost, and we can do this. And it may sound woo-woo-y to some people, and you can do it. You can be some in reacting to something and just step out. You know, literally take a breath and imagine yourself physically standing over here and going, how's she behaving? Are we good with that? You know, I had a conversation with somebody this morning, and I said, it with so much love because I really do love this person. And what I realized with our relationship has been a roller coaster ride. We adore each other, and sometimes we come at each other like. And so what I'm doing when this happens to me now is, who are these people? Because I want this to heal. And so I said to her, you're my mother. And she at first, I think, was like, oh my God, you don't like your mother. I said, I adore my mother. She pushed every button I had. And I still love her. I still love her. I will always love my mother. And so once I identified that, it was like, I don't have to respond the same way I used to respond anymore. So I got to observe. And sometimes we don't get to observe in the moment. We get, you know, what I do is if something has happened, then I get to go home and sit. I get to go home and sit with it and, you know, and look at my side of the street. That's all I get to look at. I don't get to clean up anybody else's street. Sorry. We're all our own little street cleaners. Every single one of us. Even when you're madly in love with your partner, Paul still gets to clean his street. I sometimes like to go over there. And he's like, no, my side of the street. So I get to look at how did I behave? I like to use the word, am I clean? Am I clean? And if I'm clean, then regardless of how it turned out, it's okay. If I don't feel I was clean, then I need to go to that person and sit down and have a conversation like I did this morning. Because I didn't feel clean with this person. And so that's the observe. Observing your behavior. And how, because remember, everybody gets to act exactly as they want to. Unfortunately. And we get to react exactly as we choose. And that is a lot of responsibility. And a lot of people really want to make it somebody else's fault. Oh, they did this. Oh, they did that. And the truth is, it doesn't matter what they did. Only thing that matters, me right here, how did I take that in? And did I respond with love? Or did I respond from ego or anger? Or however you choose to respond. And it's a practice. Every situation is going to be different. Every situation. It's not like this person and I may not be on a roller coaster ride. You know, I just know it's going to be more like a roller coaster where we go down a river. Not a roller coaster. There's not going to be big highs and big lows anymore. Is it going to be bumpy sometimes? God, I hope so. Otherwise, we've probably given up a little bit of our humanness. And then she wouldn't get to play my mom anymore. And I was just so happy when I identified that. It's like, oh, more healing. Yay. You know, I get to treat her better than I treated my mother when I was an adult. And that makes me feel really wonderful. What an opportunity God has given me in this moment. So V is value. And it's about the value of you. Yes, we place a lot of value on people, places, and things around us. I get that. We all do it. Or we're like, you know, we compare, stare and compare. You know, well, this person has more of this, or this person has, you know, whatever it is. This person's skinnier than I am. This person's heavier than I am. This person's hair is more beautiful than mine is. Value. Value and love of self. So value is knowing that you are here, and I wish I'd looked up the statistics. It takes a lot, excuse me for the doctorese, it takes a lot for a sperm and an egg to come together. It takes a lot. And for that to happen, and for you to then be birthed and to walk on this planet, that's a huge miracle. Just right there. Right there. And yet, what do? We devalue ourselves. We talk bad about ourselves. We, you know, whatever it is, we play that blame game with ourselves and shame game with ourselves. And that doesn't value the gift we've been given, the gift of life, the gift of God in form. And so I encourage everybody to value yourself and then celebrate that. Come here and dance in the morning. That's why we do it. I know for some people it's like, seriously, what are they doing? That's okay. I get that. You know, somebody has shared with me because, and I have never been in Michael Douglas' church, but evidently Michael's church is very uplifting and they dance and they sing and they rock and roll. And somebody had shared with me, because this happens to people sometimes, she had called Michael and said, I haven't been coming because, you know, I haven't felt joyful in it. And he went, seriously? That's when you should be there. That's when you should get up in the morning. If you don't want to put on your makeup, ladies, don't do it. If you want to come in your slippers, fine. Guys, if you don't want to comb your hair, we don't care. This is the place to shift your energy. That's why we do this. That's why there's so much joy in this room. Because collectively, we are powerful. We are powerful by ourselves and collectively, holy moly. We can change the planet. And it doesn't look like it right now, does it? However, what I believe is when light starts to shine really bright, darkness can get very fearful. And it can start popping up all over the place. Like, okay, not over here. Okay, we're not going to let it happen over here. Just keep shining. Keep being that presence. And then E is embrace. And some of you I know are very uncomfortable with the I am so glad you're here. And what I have realized, because at one point I had enough people who were like, that makes me uncomfortable. I thought maybe you shouldn't do it. And then so I sat back and just watched the energy in the room. And it works for a lot of people. And so what I suggested to this person is, nobody's watching the door. Come in when it's comfortable for you. You know, if that piece really is uncomfortable for you, then if you come and we're still doing it, go get a cup of coffee. You know, go upstairs. We have windows up there. You can sit up there. There are no rules here. The only thing that I really impress upon everybody is to really embrace your life. Embrace who you are. You are a gift. Whether you have found out what path you are on or not, you are a gift. And you're a gift to everybody sitting here. You're a gift to everybody that lives in Santa Fe and El Dorado and Taos, or I don't remember, Sandia soon. Wherever you're from, you're a gift. You know, you are a gift. And if you recognize that, wow. When I really own, I'm a gift to this community, then what I get is all the gifts that you are to me. Because what I know is, We're all mirrors for each other. Every single one of us, we're a mirror. And so what I see is, oh, wow, brilliant. Wisdom seekers, intelligence, loving, compassionate, wonderful, expressive souls. Because that's what I was told this morning is who I am. And so if that's who I am, I'm sorry, you can't be anything except that. You really can't. And so it's owning that. And it's in the uncomfortableness of owning that. And fear may come up, and doubt. And she's talking to everybody else in the room except me. Because I was that person when I first found this philosophy. I was that person. Everybody, oh gosh, yeah, the rest of you, of course, that's exactly who she's talking to. Not me. And Reverend Susie said to me, seriously, Gail, are you that arrogant? Everybody else belongs in that circle except you. I got arrogant, I'm damaged. Nobody knows my story. Nobody's fucked my. And she's like, man, tell me your story. And when I was done, her response was, really? That's the best you got? So I don't care what your story is or how separate you feel. What I know to be true is you are the power and presence of God in form, and I see it. And I know it. And someday, I know you're going to walk up to me and go, ah. And I love you all. Thank you.